Now, it is 1:57. And if at all we want an interaction with the room, we will need to extend the end of this session at about 1:20. No comment? Adopted. So, please, what I will allow first, if we have 20 minutes, this is what we have. I will allow for, let's say, 10 minutes of asking, directing a question to the panelists. And then after that, the panelists will respond, and then I will conclude. What I ask you to do is to be very disciplined. No comment, questions. And we start with women. This side, is there any woman that want to pose a question? If not, you shut up for now. This side, a woman? A question? No woman. You see, we allow women to speak, they don't want to speak. This side, women, yes, madam. Another one? Another woman? This side? No? Go ahead, madam. Another one? No. This here. Go ahead.
Yes, good afternoon. My name is Sarah Masaki from Kenya, in a county government called Murang'a County Government. My question is, the issue of resource allocation to planning actually has been addressed by the last presenter. I would like to know how it was done, because this has been a major challenge, I think, in most counties, because land and urban development is seen as a low-key sector in terms of even attracting issues of voters. So I would like the panelists to address this, because if we manage to get this right, then we can elevate physical planning to the level which it should be. If we have physical planning right, then even human settlements will become sustainable, because you plan before the settlement. How has this been addressed? And I want to also state that in Kenya, we have within our policies the need to have integrated development plans done for towns, all towns. But the challenge again has been the financing. So I would like us to address this. Thank you.
Halala SDI halala. Halala SDI halala. My name is Sarah Nandudu. And I'm not sure whether it is a question, I'll beg to be forgiven. But I just want to raise a concern, maybe. Just to say, we appreciate the commitment of the ministers that they put across in terms of inclusive cities. But on behalf as SDI, there are a few things that we should like maybe to understand. And for us, what we think what is inclusive cities means for us working together as people of different categories, maybe, but in the same city. But as you look at the situation today, the population of the city dwellers commonly stay in the slums. If we could get our statistics of any city, you discover that slum dwellers are, they carry a very big percentage of people in the city. But when you go to terms of resource sharing, maybe, or in terms of offering services, slums are not serviced. And this is a very big challenge. You'll find that no water, no sanitation, no roads, nobody minds about slums. If it's terms of planning, the slums dwellers themselves are left out. So if we're talking of inclusiveness, I would think in terms of planning, we should all be part. In terms of implementation, we should all be part. In terms of monitoring, we should all be part, so that we all carry the burden of what we are going through. So I would request and maybe say that as African ministers, we are requesting and praying that we work together so that we walk the talk. Okwegata information.
Thank you so much. Okay, the last woman, but you did wrong because we crossed already. Okay, go ahead.
Thank you very much. My name is Sabine. I work for the National Association of Local Authorities of Ghana. And my question addresses to you, Honorable, from Uganda. You said the national government made finances available to local governments to foster development. Can you share a good example with us? What has been achieved?
I take one man this side, one man here, one man here, and one man here. One man. Yes, sir. Over there.
My name is Chris Gordon. I'm the director of the Institute for Environment and Sanitation Studies of the University of Ghana. My question goes to all, and it's the specific targets under the SDG 11, target 6, relates to green spaces and the environment. How are you going to achieve this target? Thank you.
Hello. My name is Kelvin Odans. I'm from ISEC, a youth organization. So I'm directing my question to the minister.
Which organization?
ISEC.
Okay.
Youth organization. My question is to the minister from Burkina Faso. Sorry, from Uganda. He made mention of the fact that in the early days, Africa, we had well-planned cities, well-planned urban cities, and then over time it got deteriorated based on poor leadership and sensitization. So I'm asking, what strategies are we putting in place currently to ensure that in the future we don't have this kind of conference again where we are talking about sustainable urban cities and things like that? What are we doing to ensure that in the future the cities we are planning for today don't get deteriorated like it happened in the past? Thank you.
Here? Okay. Nobody's here. Fine. Last one? Where? Oh, I don't see him because of the camera. Oh, you... Okay, go ahead. But be alert when we say here, put your hand up.
Bom dia a todos e a todas. Meu nome é Mahapodo Amurani, sou de Moçambique, presidente do Conselho Municipal de Nampula. Eu anotei aqui algumas questões, mas vou ser muito breve, e vou me concentrar apenas em três pontos que foram focados. Gostaria de saber quais são os modelos relacionados ao quadro legal, a desenhos urbanísticos e acesso de financiamento para a sustentabilidade das cidades, uma vez que foi reconhecida.
It has been from the presentation early on that we have a problem of urbanization in Africa, that there is a lot of people that are moving from the rural areas to the urban centers. We've also heard that there is also a system of natural growth where the population of the urban centers is growing. Now, one of the issues that I would like our panelists to answer is about housing. We've already heard that housing is a human right. What measures are we putting in place to provide decent accommodation for the people that are coming into the areas? Recently, there was an election in London for the mayor of London. And one of the biggest issues in that election, issue of housing. Now, London is a developed city. If housing is an issue in London, how about in our developing countries? We need to put in measures that are going to address this, considering the cost and considering affordability as well. What measures are they putting in place to address this matter?
Yes, sir. It's your turn now.
Information. Yeah, my question goes, my name is Abu Haruna. I'm from Ghana Federation of Urban Poor. My question goes to all the panelists. We've been hearing urbanization, and then we used to talk about rural urban migration. But today, there's so much poverty in the cities or the urban areas. What strategies would they put in place to address urban poverty? Thank you.
Yes, my name is Richard from Kenya. I work in the county government. Now, my question is to all the panelists. Africa is urbanizing very fast. I want you to comment on the issue of urban governance versus capacity. Capacity in the sense that do we have enough technical personnel in our urban centers in terms of planning? Because our urban centers have sprawled, they are growing so fast, and faster than the planners can catch up. What are we doing to address the issue of building in urban planning in Africa? Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Jason Muchache from African Bank. I just want to raise a question which goes across all the countries represented. I had this concern that have no resources and resource allocation is minimal, in which case they are not able to carry out the plans they have set. Now, one of the normal arguments you get in development is that cities are the engines for development, which tells me that it means that the cities are the generators of resources. Dear ministers, where are the funds going from the cities? I didn't hear anyone talking about the malady in Africa or in the world, and that is lack of governance in resource management. My understanding, when we look at the cities, the amount of resources they are generating, is that they are generating resources and using it without addressing development. Is it possible that we can actually address development from the resources that we are generating in the cities? And is it possible that we can generate more resources from the cities by managing what we are addressing in those cities? Thank you.
Thank you very much for the audience. It was a very fruitful, I think, set of questions. Is run from planning to power empowerment, participation of people, resource generation and management, political leadership, empowerment. So, please, can I ask you to provide 1 minute statement for each of you around these questions. And I ask people that the minister are still here and you can still interact with them outside the panel. So please, 1 minute each. We start by our the Minister of Uganda.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. The question that seems to be coming up from many interveners is financing of the local governments with respect to planning, physical planning, and financing with respect to the cities from the center. Can I seek your indulgence? I am a lawyer by training. I believe in evidence. To you, moderator, to allow me ask one person who is a mayor of a city that has benefited from the financing from the center in half a minute to give his testimony. Am I allowed to do that? Can I proceed?
You can proceed with
it. Thank you. Mayor from Jinja, can you tell these people what the central government has helped you to achieve in your municipality? You have half a minute to do so.
Thank you very much, Honorable Minister Isaac, and thank you very much. As I've said, my name is Majid. I am the mayor, Jinja being the second largest in Uganda. It is true that the government of Uganda has instituted a new policy where they are directly financing physical planning activities in the towns. Of recent, we've got a lot of support from the government, basically to build capacity for our staff so that they can understand physical planning and they can be able to implement it properly. Also, we've got a lot of support from government to manage the resources that are geared towards physical planning that has been extended to us. Finally, we have a lot of areas of interest. Jinja is being promoted as a tourism city of Uganda, and the government of Uganda has supported us, is giving us a lot of money towards developing the infrastructure of Jinja and also those areas that are tourist attractions. We've also had support through the World Bank, largely a loan from the World Bank, lobbied for by the government of Uganda, towards road resurfacing, road reconstruction, street lighting, and improving the livelihoods of the people of Uganda. Thank you very much.
Minister. Minister, let me say this to you, because it is important that Africa know. At UCLG Africa, we rate the government as we want to see who are those governments that are friendly to cities and local government, and those who are adverse to cities and local government. And Uganda entered into this very tiny club of African countries that are friendly to local government. There are four. In this order, number one, South Africa. Number two, Uganda. Number three, Morocco. And number four, Kenya. So you see that when we are doing well, we recognize it. Thank you.
Je vais reprendre ce qu'il a dit en français. Quand on a posé la question, le ministre a dit que effectivement toutes les questions vont autour de quelles sont les ressources que les gouvernements mettent à la disposition des collectivités locales pour faire la planification et mettre en place les services aux populations. Et le ministre a posé la question à un maire, le maire de Jinja, pour qu'il réponde à sa place. Et le maire a effectivement répondu. Et là, j'ai précisé que nous avons fait un travail de classification des pays africains selon qu'ils sont plus ou moins amicaux vis-à-vis des collectivités locales. Et il y a quatre pays qui arrivent en tête, l'Afrique du Sud, l'Ouganda en deuxième, le Maroc en troisième et le Kenya en quatrième. Donc, je confirmais que l'Ouganda a effectivement fait beaucoup d'efforts pour donner plus de ressources aux collectivités locales. Voilà, c'était ça le sens de la question. Maintenant, à vous de répondre aux questions. La question
d'une manière générale, qu'est-ce que le pays fait par rapport à la planification, par rapport à la prévention des quartiers d'habitat spontané et par rapport à la capacité d'apport des infrastructures dans les villes?
Au niveau du Burkina Faso, avant donc les élections, il y avait des efforts qui étaient faits en matière de planification, quelques efforts en planification urbaine, quelques efforts en matière de résorption de l'habitat spontané, ce qu'on appelle le quartier non aménagé. Mais dans le programme quinquennal du président Roch Kabore, il y a un projet ambitieux au niveau de la planification urbaine. Je prends un exemple. Nous avons 49 communes urbaines. Depuis 50 ans, on a doté 12 communes d'outils de planification urbaine, c'est-à-dire les schémas directeurs d'aménagement et d'urbanisme. Et nous avons lancé, depuis que nous sommes arrivés il y a 6 mois, nous avons lancé rien que pour l'année 2016, 15 schémas de planification urbaine, entièrement financés par le gouvernement. Il faut dire qu'au Burkina Faso, en matière de planification urbaine et d'aménagement, les collectivités territoriales n'ont pas suffisamment de moyens. Donc, le gouvernement est obligé d'assurer ces aspects-là pour permettre un minimum d'infrastructures au niveau des d'outils de planification au niveau des collectivités territoriales, des collectivités locales, et ensuite d'aménagement, la mise en œuvre de ces outils-là, puisque le tout n'est pas de réaliser des chemins directeurs, il faut les mettre en œuvre. La mise en œuvre, c'est quoi ? C'est la dotation d'un certain nombre de projets structurants au niveau, j'ai parlé des zones d'activité économique, de l'aménagement de la voirie, de l'assainissement, etc., etc., pour permettre aux collectivités territoriales locales d'avoir un minimum de base leur permettant donc d'implémenter des programmes de développement. Nous comptons dans les 5 ans, dans le cadre du programme quinquennal, terminer les aménagements d'une 80aine de collectivités locales. Nous comptons également mettre en place un programme de construction de près de 40 000 logements répartis sur tout le territoire national, en privilégiant les zones rurales qui n'ont pas bénéficié jusqu'à ce jour d'un minimum de programmes dans ce sens. Donc, pour ce qui est des ressources, au niveau du Burkina Faso, il y a des efforts importants et nous sommes dans un processus de transfert des ressources et des compétences vers les collectivités locales. C'est-à-dire travailler à former au niveau de chaque collectivité locale, au niveau de chaque mairie, municipalité, des services urbains et transférer donc les ressources et le personnel de manière à ce que chaque municipalité puisse se prendre en charge dans le cadre du développement urbain. Merci.
Liberia.
Thank you. Several questions that were asked for environmental to planning and all of that. But one thing I want to say is that the workshop that we are participating in now, the one key thing that must come out after we share all of our ideas is an initiative that works. We are talking about changing narratives. It means we, as a people on the continent, have recognized an issue, a population explosion in urban centers. And so we want to address that. There are other governments that are ahead, to other governments that are behind. We all gather in one room. At the end of the day here, which is actually, I think, the first phase of the implementation of the African policy, might be able to identify those initiatives that will take us to where we want to be as a continent, to take advantage of this resource that we have, which is the human element. Now, on green spaces, it's good that the person who asked the question comes from a city that is ranking number 2 in terms of the government assistance to those cities. It all has to be area-specific. If a country has a problem of that nature, it has to be legislated. It comes from the land law, land issue, land tenure of land tenure. Those issues will be able to address whether you see a particular space in the city and you define it as the mayor of the city to be an area that you want to put some kind of public area on that will uplift your income or the beauty of the city. It got to be negotiated based on your land regulations, your land law. The model for sustainability. Somebody asked the question, what is there a model? It cannot be one model for all cities in Africa. There has to be based on your laws, your regulations. And that's why when we are discussing here, we are identifying the areas of problems that will be challenging. For us in Liberia, the issue of land ownership still remains a serious challenge. Somebody spoke, one of the ministers, that individuals own land in the past. So we've just legislated a land act that streamlining all of the problems that have been given of difficulties in terms of our own development strategies. And most of all, the issue of decentralization, giving local authorities certain powers and authorities, be it disaggregation of budget, revenue sharing with central authorities, why we maintain a central regulation, giving those cities and those local authorities the powers that it need to intervene and respond to this emerging trend is something that must again be regulated. And so once we identify it here and we identify as a strategy, then those, our implementing partner, there are a whole lot of experts that will help us to put into place an African strategy as a result of the first major workshop that City Alliance is hosting. How we had resource governance. Well, if cities are giving money to manage, it's like central government is giving money to manage. The accountability, which we spoke about earlier, is part of human existence. If you are giving funds, you are over funds to manage it, whether to construct a city or maintain a city, manage the population. There's an issue of accountability where you report to those who entrust you with a fund. So I think with that intervention, Mr. Moderator, I will pause here and say that those are things that we have to brainstorm about during the rest of the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Mozambique.
Muito obrigado. Eu vou começar pela questão relacionada com a pobreza. Eu defendo que, se nós queremos atacar a pobreza, temos de tomar em conta que, em África, no geral, o rosto da pobreza está na mulher. E exatamente por causa disto, temos que apostar muito em dois aspectos fundamentais: a formação da mulher e a questão de acesso ao financiamento. Se nós conseguirmos apostar muito na formação da mulher e no acesso ao financiamento, acredito que teremos meio caminho andado rumo à redução das grandes diferenças sociais que nós sentimos, sobretudo nas cidades. É por causa dessa razão que o nosso governo, o governo de Moçambique, neste momento tem estado a criar condições de acesso a financiamento a custo muito baixo, não só para mulheres, para mulheres, para jovens, através de mecanismos de encaminhamento de recursos do governo para implementação de projetos de rendimento, mas com maior enfoque para jovens e mulheres. Isto tem estado a provar que, não resolvendo na totalidade o problema da pobreza, mas pelo menos começam a alterar aquilo que é a estrutura social das famílias, sob o ponto de vista de acesso a recursos. Mas é verdade que isso não resolve, isso por si só não resolve o problema. Há todo outro conjunto de elementos complementares que devem ser tomados em conta. Mas se nós continuamos a apostar muito na formação da mulher, no acesso ao financiamento da mulher, no acesso ao financiamento aos jovens, acredito que esses elementos podem ajudar, de certa maneira, a criar alguma estabilidade nas cidades, sem descurar a necessidade de apostarmos noutras vertentes. Sobre a questão de planeamento e ordenamento, eu sempre assumi que, se nós queremos resolver o problema das cidades, o nosso programa de planeamento e ordenamento não tem que estar concentrado apenas nas cidades. Nós temos que desenhar uma estratégia combinada entre a estratégia da zona urbana, a estratégia da zona periurbana e a estratégia da zona rural. E se nós elaborarmos uma estratégia combinada, isso vai permitir que apostemos em infraestruturas não só na zona urbana, mas também na zona periurbana e na zona rural, que é desses locais onde as pessoas saem e vão para as cidades. Se nós concentrarmos apenas no desenvolvimento urbano, sem tomarmos em conta o desenvolvimento da zona periurbana, as infraestruturas que vamos aumentando na zona urbana, elas não vão responder cabalmente às necessidades, porque o fluxo de campo para a cidade vai continuar. É por essa razão que no nosso país temos estado a trabalhar muito nesta visão combinada de desenvolvimento entre a zona urbana e a zona periurbana. Há uma outra questão relacionada com acesso à habitação. Em Moçambique, nós consideramos que acesso à habitação tem sido uma das grandes dores de cabeça, acredito que é dor de cabeça em África. Mas o primeiro maior problema no acesso à habitação não é casa em si, é como é que o cidadão tem acesso à terra que é para poder ter casa. E muitas das vezes o problema é que o acesso à terra é tão oneroso que a pessoa, mesmo conseguindo dinheiro só para comprar a terra, já não tem dinheiro para construir. É por essa razão que o governo tem estado a trabalhar no sentido de criar zonas onde são infraestruturadas e cria-se mecanismos facilitados de acesso à terra, particularmente para jovens, que é a camada que tem tido muitos problemas. Temos uma vantagem porque em Moçambique a terra é do Estado. O Estado atribui ao cidadão para a sua utilização. É verdade que conflitos de terra não podem faltar, porque a necessidade de terra ela é crescente. Mas o primeiro passo, se nós queremos resolver o problema de habitação, temos que resolver a questão do acesso à terra. Porque se nós conseguimos resolver o problema de acesso à terra, aí sim podemos ir por outra via, buscar financiamento para efeito de construção de casas por aí fora. Mas porque o tempo é limitado, acredito que o resto poderemos tratar em ocasiões futuras. Muito obrigado.
Thank you. And finally, Ghana.
The question of city planning and how we put the structures together to achieve that, I think, has been clearly handled in the Ghanaian situation with a national body, which we call the National Development Planning Commission, as the overarching body that is regulating the national development plan. And it is done in a way as to look at not just short-term interventions, but the broader national scope and longer-term approach to our development regime. This we have seen with the launch of the 40-year development plan, which is very, very futuristic in its approach, and it is also localized to the extent that our town and country planning department of our cities or assemblies are empowered to be in charge of the planning regime, which is the physical planning. And so we do have regulations and the act to back our activities. But indeed, Ghana also do have the challenges of land ownership, and it is similar to what my colleagues have expressed. In all these, I would want to sum up by saying that we have a deliberate agenda to use cities as centers of economic development and social change. And these we see in the way we are going about the spatial planning, and also how we're creating industrial park and ICT parks in our country. Consciously, we have a cone in the way these in economic development or economic environment that is being generated through cities are done. And so on the coastline, we have the Accra, Tema area, and then the western region, Takoradi area, which are strong economic base. In the middle belt, we have the Kumasi or Ashanti region, which is supposed to harness the central part. And then in the northern sector, we're promoting this agenda with the Tamale area. The second thing we are doing with cities is to use infrastructure to create that sustainable development that we anticipate. This has been achieved with the leadership of His Excellency himself spearheading this agenda. And we are seeing major, major improvement in our housing infrastructure. The gap is being bridged for specific sectors and for general residents. And that should address the concerns of our slum dwellers, because we have targeted programs that are dealing with slum upgrades. You come to Tema and we have identified such places and having specific interventions to support low-income earners. And most of our foreign support by way of funding are also targeting low-income communities. And so today, the goal is to reduce open-air defecation, for example. And most of the districts or cities in Accra are consciously increasing access to sanitation facilities, which would address that issue for our slum dwellers. Let me also say that we have seen increasing infrastructural development in the area of health, education, and housing in these times, and these are all geared towards improving our cities and making infrastructure connect cities to open up economic activities. This we see in the Eastern Corridor Road, which is connecting about 29 cities, and so that corridor is going to open and create more economic base for our cities along that corridor. I want to believe that it is important that the resources that we have are well managed, and I think my colleagues alluded to that. And we have a constitutional provision for central government funding support for our cities, and 7.5% of the national revenue is directed to cities and local authorities for specific development programs. And sometimes there are even guidelines and regulations to ensure that special attention is given to, say, slums or health care delivery or education. And so we do have this management regime, improving governance at local level. And I want to agree with all the speakers on the need for training and building capacities of the city managers, because we ought to manage the resources we have so we can take advantage to create the lively cities we all anticipate. I think I will leave it at this and hope that I have covered our case well. Thank you.
Thank you so much. My duty is now to try and get takeaways from what you just said. And you said a lot. And I will do that with reference to what Billy Cobet told us this morning, that we need three key transformation to address cities as structural engine for transformation of this continent. The first one is transformation of mindset. What we listen from the ministers is that we don't see any government adverse to cities and cities development. We even saw Uganda saying that the head of state said that we should live from a mindset of refraining rural urban migration to a mindset of accepting this and building on this to transform Uganda. So there is no adversity to urbanization anymore. Number two, we all of them recognize that cities can be engine of growth. And they can consider, because previously they were saying agriculture is the engine of growth of Africa. Now they are saying cities can be engine of growth. I think there are conditions attached to that, but at least the mindset is there that cities are now recognized as engine of growth. The second transformation that Billy mentioned this morning is the transformation of the governance perspective of cities. Governance of cities. And what I hear ministers saying is that, yes, they are for sustainable cities, meaning they want to take a resilience perspective to plan our cities. I hear them saying that they are for inclusive cities, and were challenged by SDI representatives here that this is not very much seen on the ground, but this is addressed to the mayors, not to the ministers. And because you ask for more inclusiveness of poor city dwellers, slum dwellers, into the management and the governance of the city. Question raised, can we plan ahead before people come and avoid this very costly retrofitting? Well, you said that to plan ahead, we need to consider a continuum of human settlement from rural to megapolis, and not be concentrated and focused only on cities if we want to be successful. This is point taken. You say also that to plan ahead, we need to seriously address the land issue, and you didn't get us any solution on that. So we'll have to come back to it during the coming debates, because apparently the issue of land is a daunting one, and apparently every government is struggling to have it solved, and we don't see how. Then the last one is the transformation of the running of the city. And you rightly insist on the fact that we need good governance. We need more transfer to local government, and we are doing it. We need more skilled professionals at local government, and we need better leadership, not only at the national level, but also at the local level. I think with that, you've done your job. I think me also. I thank you all.